Well, I'm disappointed, ladies and gentlemen. Do you want to know why? You want to know why I'm disappointed? It's because I was supposed to do this video today as a gosh darn vampire. And I don't see any fancy cloaks, okay? Because it seems, whereas I originally assumed that a certain character in One Piece is now a vampire, it seems like they are actually not. Rather, it seems like they're another very prominent demon-winged being that bites people. Similar to a vampire, but not exactly a vampire. And I'm just a little disappointed in that, as all. Okay, well, anyway, this is going to be a little bit of a deconstruction breakdown of chapter 1072. Spoilers for chapter 1072. I think it's just because there hasn't been any One Piece for like a month, but there was a lot of stuff included in this chapter, okay? And it's honestly like all over the place. Like, seriously, I just want everybody to appreciate the flow of this chapter and the cliffhanger therein. You know what I mean? Yeah, technically speaking, Oda did foreshadow this at the beginning of the chapter, is sort of like bookending it. You know, like at the beginning of the chapter, we get Vegapunk's journal, and at the end of the chapter, but that doesn't actually answer any questions. That just kind of like, hey, there was this person that was cloned a long time ago, and at the end of the chapter, Stussy's a vampire or a succubus, whatever. Succubus. She's probably a succubus. She could still be a vampire, but like. Oh my God, that's so weird because the rest of the chapter has nothing to do with that. It's like, all right, we're learning about Mads a little bit. Now we're learning about Vegapunk and Bonnie, and then the Seraphim and the Cipherpool are attacking the lab. And it's like, okay, a lot of stuff is going on here. Which direction are we going to go about it? Are we going to have a cliffhanger with Kuma's memories? Are we going to have a cliffhanger with Vegapunk? A cliffhanger with the Seraphim? A cliffhanger with Zoro and Brook fighting against Kaku and Lucci? And then Stussy's a freaking succubus. It's like, okay. That came out of left field, but you know what? I'm fine with it. All right. Well, actually, there's a couple of other things. We're going to go chronologically here. I think it'd rather be pertinent to do that. I'll save the stuff for Stussy at the end of the video. That will be the main attraction, but there's some other things I want to go over first, okay? So, the first thing in the chapter to, you know, of note is actually in the cover page or the cover series, the German Double Six's Emotionless Excursion, where we have Caesar, Queen, and Judge in their younger years developing weapons for peace. Now, Judge is just working on his war spear that he uses when he's in his Garuda form. Queen is just using some, you know, beakers and chemistry. He's Breaking Bad. But we see Caesar there with a devil fruit. And the devil fruit, as I noted in the review, is it looks a lot more like a regular devil fruit, albeit the design is a little different. It doesn't have the swirly pattern, but you know, the stem looks very similar to a regular devil fruit, as opposed to the apple smiles that he eventually would develop for Kaido's crew, okay? A lot of people seem to be under the impression that that devil fruit, there were some people that were saying that could have been Kaido's, like Momonosuke's fruit. Momonosuke's clearly looked differently, although that could have been a prototype of the Uaua no Mi model Azure Dragon. I guess it's very possible. Kaido was captured a bunch of times by the Marines and was probably experimented on at Punk Hazard quite a bit. So, you know, I don't think there was just one instance where Kaido was imprisoned and he had his, like, DNA, his blood sample taken. You know what I mean? He was captured quite a bit. So, that could have been the first, you know, prototype version of what would later become the Uaua no Mi, you know, that Momonosuke ate at Punk Hazard, you know, which Vegapunk still deems as a failure, but overall still very successful. You know, it could have also have been like, it could have honestly have been the devil fruit that leads to Stussy's current status, whether it be the vampire zone or the succubus zone or whatever. I just wanted to mention the fruit because it looked rather unusual compared to the smiles that we see later. And this could also make sense because at this point, remember, Caesar was working alongside Vegapunk developing these weapons, okay? So Caesar on his own came up with the sad and then the artificial smiles that he sold to Doflamingo and then Kaido and everything like that. But in this instance, years ago, when they were first beginning this research, when they're probably more in their early stages of Devil Fruit research, Vegapunk was also there assisting Caesar. So, you know, maybe that's why the Devil Fruit looked a little bit differently. But I feel like it's going to be brought up again, whether or not it's the prototype of Momonosuke's fruit or if it was the fruit that Stussy consumed. You know, I assumed that the original person that Stussy was cloned from had a devil fruit, and then the clone also had the same devil fruit, which is totally possible because we've already established devil fruits to manipulate your DNA, your lineage factor in some way. So it's completely possible that a clone of a devil fruit user would also have the same devil fruit. But we just don't know yet. We don't really know. The Seraphim are a little different because the Seraphim, well, there are a lot of stuff going on with them. But we're actually going to get back to the Seraphim here later on. So yeah, just pay attention to that devil fruit in the cover page. I feel like that's going to be relevant. Next up, this is more of just a pun, but I forgot to mention it. It went over my head in the review. So Bonnie has the ability with her aging devil fruit to strike an opponent and then knock out various gems and jewels and stuff out of their body. And then that's like essentially their age crystallized in form of jewelry. And a lot of people were quick to bring up, wait a second, her name's Jewelry Bonnie and she creates jewelry. Da-da-da-da-da-da. I'm like, okay, yeah, all right. Yeah, that makes sense. Probably nothing really else to it. That's just more of a pun on Oda's part, but it did fly right over my head during the review, so wanted to bring that up. She has the ability to summon jewelry. It's a little weird, I will admit, because she's very clearly shown the ability to manipulate other characters' ages without doing that, without knocking out the gems first. That might just be for added flair. Because physical contact was still required in both instances. But then she can also turn, you know, she can change the ages of characters without coming into physical contact with them, as we saw with the Marines and Sabaody. So I'm not really sure if this ability, I mean, like, she stated that it was not, it wasn't permanent. Okay, when she knocked out Vegapunk's age and turned him into a baby, she specifically mentioned that my ability does not work permanently on living things, okay, only on inanimate objects. She might be the sole exception to that. Or rather, I was even thinking about this. Even if Bonnie is not the sole exception to that, let's say she, if she turns herself into an old lady, given enough time, she would revert naturally as well. It's just that she has the devil fruit, so she can keep activating it over and over and over again, but there is still kind of like a time limit, sort of like a cool down period where she activates the ability, turns into like an 80-year-old woman, and it's like, in 5 minutes I will revert. Oh, I'm reverting, I'll just turn back. Okay, here we go, because she has the power, she could just keep doing it. Or she just might be able to stay in those forms, you know, indefinitely, because she's the user. Something that I thought, though, was, okay, what if it's like she knocks out the gems or the jewelry of a character, and those gems do represent different increments of age. Like, you pick up, like, a little tiny pearl, and that's only, like, 1 month of age, nothing really that big. But there were also, like, giant diamonds and giant, like, star-shaped gems of, like, amethyst or whatever inside of that. You know, like, oh, this is, like, 10 years of age. What would happen necessarily? I guess they can't be put back in, because Vegapunk was, like, picking them up, and I guess they wouldn't go right back into him. But would it be possible to pick up the gem or the diamond or the sapphire or whatever and, like, put it in somebody else, and then they would gain the age or lose the age that it's representative of? And then it's just after a certain amount of time, all the gems just go back to where their original users were. Like, that's the thing, because, like, Vegapunk got all the jewelry knocked out of him, and then Jewelry's, like, Jewelry Bonnie is just like, oh, it's not permanent. So after a certain amount of time, what happens? Do all the gems just magically just float up in the air and then just go flying back into Vegapunk? I guess it could, possibly, sure. It's just a little bit of an interesting design choice for the Devil Fruit. Never saw that before. You know, the distorted future thing that Bonnie used, I kind of feel like that was what I said in the review, with it being like her being able to manipulate different paths of future. I think Oda's definitely going along the Back to the Future Part 3 sort of message with it, where at the end of Back to the Future Part 3, Doc Brown is like, you know, the future isn't set in stone, it's whatever you make of it, so make it a good one. And thank you, Christopher Lloyd. But anyway, yeah, the thing is, because there's so many different like paths of possible futures, I think Oda's going around the line that like, nothing is set in stone here, you know, like things are still up in the air on how the characters' futures are going to be, and it really doesn't make much sense for Bonnie just to have a static ability. I guess she could just have it like, oh, I will turn myself, if things just keep going the way they are right now, this is how my future is going to look, and this is how I'll end up. But it also is just a lot cooler for her to maybe be an awakened user of her aging fruit, and that awakening allows her to access different possible futures. So there's a normal future where she's just this shriveled up old lady, or there's another future where she gets really buff, you know, she hits the gym, and she turns into that giant hulking buff form that we saw in the chapter. So, yeah, I think that's honestly what it's about there. I think she is awakened, and her power is just really, you know, really multifaceted in that regard. This is just a small thing. So when Bonnie walks over to the door that has the paw print on it, and she's like, oh, this is, you know, something related to my father, I was kind of curious why she knew like that. Like, she was kind of drawn to that door, and I thought it had something to do with observation hockey. But no, it was literally in the chapter, and I just missed it. You can hear the beeping in the room. So she's like holding Vegapunk up, and she's like, you know, tell me what you did to my father. Why did you kill him? And then she's like, beep, 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 beep. It's like, wait, what's going on in that room? Now, it's a little interesting because this is Vegapunk's lab we're talking about here. There's a lot of beeping going on. You know, there's a lot of random whirling and beeping and zapping and stuff. I mean, it's a mad scientist lab, basically. So why did that room start beeping right when Bonnie was talking about it? And also, that's a particular beeping that she's like, wait a second, this lab that has a bunch of beeping and noises going on, that one particular room beeping, that's drawing something from me. I don't know what's going on. I'm gonna go see what's up with that. And then she sees the paw print on the door. So I don't know, you could go along the lines of like Kuma's soul or Kuma's memories are messing with the technology and they sense that Bonnie is nearby or something, because they are, you could say Kuma's memories are his soul in a sense. So maybe Kuma's soul can manipulate things. Okay, so talking about the soul very briefly, this was something I should have definitely gone into a little bit more, because in the review, it might have come off like I was saying that, like, Vegapunk's trying to prove the existence of a soul in One Piece, and everybody's like, teching, dude, souls already exist. Brook exists, you know? Brook is rock and roll skeleton guy. He has the power of the soul fruit. That's literally, oh, no, he doesn't have the power of the soul fruit. Big Mom has the power of the soul fruit, which is also something that's proving that souls do in fact exist, but Brook has the ability to revive his soul from the dead. Souls exist. I should have clarified. I know souls exist in One Piece. What Vegapunk is attempting to do is actually figure out the weight of a soul. Like, the souls have some kind of physical mass or matter that can be interacted with. That's what Vegapunk was really messing with right now. Although it does bring up an interesting question. We have the soul fruit by Big Mom, and she was a Yonko, so I feel like her ability would be well known throughout the world, so I feel like Vegapunk would know about the existence of the soul fruit. That would probably be one he would definitely want to research. And then we have Brook, who maybe Vegapunk doesn't know about the Yomi Yomi no Mi. I mean, the fact that it is that just by the nature of the Yomi Yomi no Mi, it doesn't get reincarnated as often as other devil fruits because it literally gives the user a second chance of life. Brook died when he was relatively young. He was only 38 when he died. But in theory, if you eat the Yomi Yomi no Mi when you're a little kid, and then you live to the ripe old age of like 110, and then you come back, and then you live your second life, which could be maybe over another 100 years, that takes the Yomi Yomi no Mi out of circulation for like 2 centuries right then and there. Okay, keep in mind, remember, One Piece characters tend to live a little longer than the characters in our world. Oh, we're all just characters in the game of life, ladies and gentlemen. We're all just in the Matrix. But, no, so maybe Vegapunk doesn't know about the Yomi Yomi no Mi, but that does raise some questions. It would be rather fascinating for him to study Brook and see what's going on here. Vegapunk has yet to actually see Brook, because Brook stayed on the ship. I want to see, and it might not happen right here and now at Egghead, but when Vegapunk leaves with the Straw Hats, they get on the ship, they fly away, that's when Brook walks out, and he's just like, hello there, Vegapunk, we didn't get a chance to formally meet. My name is Brook. And then Vegapunk's just like, oh my god, a skeleton! It's like, oh no, I ate the Yomi Yomi no Mi. I'm a revive human. And then Vegapunk is like, can I study you? And then Brook is probably like, yeah, I don't care. I'm cool with that. You know? You know, if you can ask Lilith over there to show me her, see where that's probably going. Yeah, okay, you can see where that's probably going. But anyway, no, so, but the soul thing, okay? Something else about this, rather fascinating, and I didn't even realize this. There are people that commented this. This is what I love about the fact, and Oda even brings this up in SBSs. There are so many people that go through this story with a fine-tooth comb, all right? And so they don't, nothing gets past them, all right? So I know a lot about One Piece, but you know, I miss the mark a lot of times when I'm reviewing the chapters and I don't pay attention to like certain things or whatever, okay? But this is something that was so obscure, I probably wouldn't have gotten it unless somebody actually directly mentioned it to me, okay? So, Vegapunk mentions the whole 21 grams experiment thing, which is a real experiment that took place in real life by a guy named MacDougall back at the beginning of the 20th century. However, in the One Piece world, Vegapunk mentions that it was conducted by a certain scientist in the West Blue, all right? And he's the one that did this 21 grams experiment, okay? Now, who do we know in the One Piece world that's a scientist or maybe a doctor that conducts, let's say, less than moral kind of experiments on people? He doesn't really have any scruples when it comes to, like, messing around with, you know, people's bodies, you know, stuff like that, and who's also from the West Blue. Yeah, that would be, in case you're curious, Dr. Hogback, ladies and gentlemen. Yes, falsa, falsa, falsa. Okay, so, yeah, some people were like, maybe it was Hogback, and I'm like, holy crap, that makes so much sense, okay? Because you could picture Hogback doing that, all right? If anybody was going to conduct the 21 grams experiment in the One Piece world, you could see Hogback, you know, in his lab or whatever, being like, I wonder if the soul has weight. Gather together all of my patients that are about to die, or maybe I'll nudge them along a little bit. You could see Hogback getting like 50 people. You know, when MacDougall did the experiment, there was only 6, okay? Not with freaking Hogback, okay? He's gonna have a larger sample size. You could see Hogback getting 100 patients in a room all sitting on scales, and then they all happen to die at the same time, just purely by accident. And then, you know, he measures them all, and then Hogback is like, falsa, 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 falsa! They're all exactly 21 grams lighter, therefore that's the weight of the soul. And we've already established the soul does exist in One Piece, so it might actually have weight, okay? The 21 grams experiment might be, like, legit in the One Piece world. And I could totally see Hogback as the dude that did that. And the thing is, we don't really know what happened to Hogback, honestly. Hogback is one of the mysterious four. We know where Perona's at. Absalom's dead. We know where Mori is at. He was at Hachinosu last time we saw him. What happened to Hogback? Apparently, he's still around because Moria had zombies at Hachinosu, so Hogback must still be making marionettes for him. It's just we haven't seen him at all since the time skip, since he was defeated by Chopper and Robin, and then he was kind of on the ship getting taken away from Thriller Bark, and that was the last time we saw him. But yeah, it's probably Hogback that conducted that experiment that Vegapunk is alluding to. All right, so I just wanted to bring that up because that was rather fascinating. Let's see here. There were some people mentioning that Kuma had his bear ears, and I thought it was maybe some kind of hairstyle, or maybe he was part mink or something. And people were like, "Oh, what if it's just because he ate the Niku Niku Nomi, the pawpaw fruit? What if it's because he has the paws, he also gets the ears?" And I'm thinking, "Oh yeah, okay, it could just be a side effect of his devil fruit too. That makes sense. He's got paws, so he gets ears. It's just like a little thing that's like a little trait that gets added with the devil fruit. That makes sense." Okay, here's a big one. Before we get to Stussy and her status as a vampire, you know, succubi or whatever, there's a big thing in this chapter that apparently I missed, where people are now thinking Sanji is a seraphim. And the reason for this is because Sanji, you know, he was talking about the seraphim, and then Nami tells Sanji to go fight, you know, alongside Zoro to help him. And so Sanji leaves, and there's like a little bit of a pun, a little bit of a joke involving the word seraphim. And so Sanji's just kind of like, oh, okay, I guess Mia Frim is going to go save him because, you know, me, Seraphim, so me Rafim, and then Frankie says swirl a fim, you know, because Sanji has the swirl, and it's like, okay, so they're making jokes regarding the name Seraphim, like puns regarding the name. And so that's what I just assumed it was. It was just a pun, but everyone's like, Sanji's gonna be a Seraphim, and I'm like, Okay, yeah, I mean, he kind of already is. I mean, like, honestly, if you just want to look at all of the Germa siblings as, like, prototype, seraphim, they kind of are, you know what I mean? It's just that Judge and Caesar and Queen and Vegapunk all sort of had the same kind of body of knowledge working in Mads together. Then they all went their separate ways. Vegapunk is clearly the master here. He's the one that takes it to the next level. He's clearly the best when it comes to science, okay? He's like Jimmy Neutron, like in more ways than one. He's got the giant head. But Caesar and Queen and Judge, they're nothing to slack at either. They have science as well. It's just they're not just as good at it. So maybe Judge arrived at the conclusion of Seraphim a long time ago, but he went about it a different way. It wasn't the same way these Seraphim were built, with Luna. Lunarian DNA plus warlord DNA plus artificial devil fruits thrown in there and the green blood. What color do the Germa siblings bleed? I think it's just regular blood, right? I think we've seen them bleed before. I think they're all just regular red blood. If it was intended for the Germa siblings to have green blood, I think that would have been mentioned in the manga. Like if like Ichiji got hit by Katakuri or something, and it's like he's bleeding, Katakuri would be like, "Your blood is green." Like I feel like Oda would have made a point to mention that. Sanji definitely bleeds. No, Sanji definitely bleeds green. We've seen it. No, he bleeds red. We've seen his blood before. And actually, that was a whole thing because of the nosebleeds at Fishman Island. He definitely bleeds red. So it might be Judge kind of coming to the same idea of like maybe combining some stuff together to make a seraphim. He wouldn't have called them seraphim, but then Vegapunk took it to the whole new level and made like perfect super soldiers kind of thing, right? Which he refers to as the strongest living beings in the entire world as the seraphim, all right? So I don't think Sanji's going to turn out to be like an actual seraphim. I think that might also just because he can control fire with his leg and maybe people want him to have like some Lunarian DNA in there. I think it was mostly just a joke, and we already know Sanji's like been so modified at this point. Like, if you were going to say that he was like Judge's version of a seraphim, like, yeah, sure, why not? Yeah, I'm okay with that. But now we're getting to the pièce de résistance, the crème de la crème, other French terms. Stussy being a vampire succubus. Okay, she's probably a succubus. All right, I can dream. Can I please just dream that there is a sexy vampire lady in One Piece, please? But no, sexy succubi. All right, it's just like, vampires up here, succubi's kind of down here. Still very high up, but whatever. All right. So, yeah, she's got the demon wings and she's got the, seductiveness going on, and she bit Kaku's neck, sure, but didn't really drain. I mean, she definitely drank some of his blood. I mean, she was like slurping up the blood at the end of the chapter, but it kind of knocked Kaku out, which maybe led to more of like a hypnotic kind of just like, go to sleep kind of effect, which vampires do tend to have. Although vampires, the way vampires' usual hypnotism works is like, go to sleep. And you're like, okay. Usually when they bite you, it's usually draining your blood and turning you into an undead thrall of theirs. Also, it's important to keep in mind anybody that actually knows a lot about vampires, like, because there's a lot of stuff written. I mean, vampires go back in the, they're just the folklore of human beings for literally thousands of years as these monsters of the night that, devour the living, that come back from the dead. I mean, there's a lot of stuff written about on vampires. And obviously, then we get into the 1800s with like John Polidori's Vampire, and then eventually Bram Stoker's. There was another one called Varney the Vampire. The 1800s is really when vampire fiction started really taking off crazy. I should also honestly, oh man, it's such a tangent. I don't even think I should bring it up, but maybe some of these days, one of these days, I'll tell you the story about how a volcanic eruption led to the creation of Frankenstein and Dracula. But it's a long story, so we'll wait for another day to tell you. But that's when, vampire fiction started there. So vampires, what my point is, have a lot of abilities. throughout various different types of fiction. Sometimes they have abilities in certain types of fiction they don't have in other types, you know what I mean? And sometimes this is actually played as like a subversion where there'll be like a series and it'll be like, oh, you think vampires need invitations to walk into a house? That's a gross oversimplification, or that's a stereotype to vampires. You know, I remember they did that in Angel a few times, you know, the spinoff to Buffy. You know, they did that a few times where Angel was like, you know, that's a stereotype against vampires. You don't understand what it's like. You know, so that's kind of like that. So Oda could really pretty much make, if there was going to be a vampire in One Piece, Oda could pretty much make the rules whatever he wants to be. So even if it's just like, ah, Stussy doesn't seem to be a vampire because don't vampires do this? I'm like, they kind of do whatever the author at the time really wants them to do, honestly. So yeah, by the way, how is that new television show, that new version of Interview with a Vampire? I haven't seen it yet, but I really want to check it out, okay? I mean, because I was really excited for that with the trailers and everything. But anyway, okay. So, okay, she's probably not a vampire, but she could be. More likely a succubus. Okay, everybody knows what a succubus is. Like, bat, demon wings. She's a demon of seduction and lust. You know, she draws men to her and everything like that, and, like, rips out and sucks out their soul, basically. I could be more like Stussy. Now, more importantly than if she's a vampire or a succubi, which, by the way, are probably both zones. It could be the Bato Bato no Mi model vampire, because that's the fruit that Patrick Redfield had in the video game. You know, and even though it is non-canon, Oda has actually done that before. I think there's another devil fruit in the story that was originally in a video game form, and then Oda took it and then added it to the... Okay, you know which one it was? It was actually Lily and Stomach's Devil Fruit, but she was also a non-canon character. So there was a character in, like, the One Piece video games from back in, like, 2005, like, on a Game Boy Advance video game, you know? It was a character named Bruce, and he was a giant, and he had the ability to, like, change his height with the Mini Nomi. And then Lily, later on, has the exact same Devil Fruit. But both of those characters are non-canon. Okay, so that's just how it is there. There's also, I think, in the same video game with Patrick Redfield, who has the Vampire Zone, the Vampire Mythical Zone, there's a pen that consumed the Mythical Tanuki Zone. So the pen can turn into a Tanuki. Now, there is a Tanuki fruit that's canon, and it's just the normal zone, though, because tanukis, like raccoon dogs, actually exist in Japan as, like, an actual animal, and so that's the one that we saw that Tea Kettle had at Wano, okay? So, I mean, like, it really comes down to Oda's preference, like, if he wants it to be, like, I'm just gonna use this vampire zone from a video game in the actual manga. He could totally do that. There's nothing stopping him from doing that. Succubus, it could be the same thing. It could be the demon fruit model succubus, or the human fruit model succubus. Actually, if it was the demon fruit, okay, I really want there to be vampires in One Piece, but introducing the demon fruit lineage of a mythical zone variant, that has potential. That has some potential in endgame One Piece, let me tell you right now. All right, so she could have that. Now, is it a devil fruit that she ate? You know, because she is, we also find out, on top of being, see, this is why this stuff doesn't, like, click in the same way. It's like, it's not related at all. Like, by the way, Stussy, she's a clone. Oh, all right. She's also a succubus. Like, what does that have to do with anything? Like, okay, she is. All right, whatever. I love this, though. Okay. So, did she have this ability just inherently? Meaning, did the original person she was cloned from, Buckingham Stussy, have the ability of this devil fruit, and just cloning her was enough to get the power? Or was it a fruit that she ate later? Maybe possibly the devil fruit we saw Caesar with at the beginning of the chapter. Something else is the person she was cloned from, Miss Buckingham Stussy. This is Miss Bucking, okay? I got a few comments saying that, like, wait a second, but her name is Miss Bucking, not Miss Buckingham, you know, or Miss Bucking. So it's... the pronunciation of her name changes depending on the version. Sometimes it's Bakkin, like B-A-K-K-I-N. Sometimes it's Buckin, you know, like buck, like a male deer, you know, it's like that. But if you look at her name in the katakana, like how it's actually written, how Oda writes her name in Japanese in katakana, so this is how her name is written. And then if you look at it would be in katakana as well, because Buckingham Palace is obviously, or Buckingham, the location, is obviously not a native Japanese location, so that's also written in katakana. So if you look at it that way, it starts in the exact same way. Miss Buckin, and then Buckingham, you know? So obviously the hamu part is added, but it starts off in the exact same way. That's the reference. It's Miss Bucking, definitely. And her full name is Miss Buckingham Stussy. It also kind of goes back to the whole thing where we're not sure how these words are pronounced at first. The key example of this is look at Laugh Tale. When the name of the island was first mentioned by Crocus all the way back at the Twin Capes, he calls it in the katakana, it's written the same way. It's not like Oda changes the way it's spelled. It's just that when we first said it or first saw it, it was like, is that Raft Tell? Because Raft is like, maybe it's Raftel. So Raftel kind of became the proper pronunciation of it for years, because we just didn't know. It was never clarified until Oda finally did clarify it, actually in Stampede with the Eternal Pose that we saw. And it's not actually spelled, it's not pronounced Raftel as in like a raft. It's Laugh Tale, which R's and L's in Japanese can be kind of swapped out. So not Raftel, Laugh Tale. Same thing with Miss Bucking. It's like, how is that pronounced? Like, why? It was like, and oh, the reference is Buckingham Palace. Okay, I get it now. There you go. Okay. So, yeah, she might have had this ability as well. We didn't really see her using it, but also she hasn't been in the story all that much. We saw her, like, twice, really. She was in the story when she first got introduced alongside Weevil, when we first saw them. And then later on, she shows up when the Marines kind of formed that blockade around Weevil with the blast shields and, like, the riot shields. Like, Edward Weevil, you're coming with us! And then Weevil's like, Mama, why are the Marines attacking us? I thought we were friends! And then Miss Bucking is just like, ah, I see. Well, I guess they turned on us. Wipe them all out, honey! Okay, Mama, I will! You know? And so, I'm assuming all those Marines died, and they're out there still rampaging through the New World, okay? Those are the only times we saw her. She might have this ability. She might just sprout bat wings and be floating around or whatever. She might have been a straight-up succubi when she was on Rox's crew. Maybe that's what Whitebeard saw in her, or maybe, what if Miss Bucking, like, used the succubus ability to kind of, like, attract Whitebeard, and Whitebeard was like, he didn't fall for it, he's just like, that power won't work on me. But anyway, and then they start, Weevil might be, oh yeah, by the way, now we're getting into clones in One Piece. Clones already existed, but now clones are more common. What if Weevil's just a straight-up clone of Whitebeard? That's a popular theory now. What if Miss Bucking got her hands on maybe some of the DNA, and then using her know-how, she created a clone of Whitebeard who is Weevil? Okay? Now, how would Miss Bucking know about this? Well, that's a fun thing. So you know how in the cover page last time we got to see the members of MADS when they first formed, and we saw that woman there with her back turned that was so obviously Stussy? Well, it was obviously Stussy, probably not this Stussy, probably not, you know, the one that's in Cipher Pool Zero right now that bit Kaku in the last chapter. That Stussy is probably Miss Buckingham Stussy in her younger years. She was probably the one that joined MADS. She was the one that developed clone tech, and it was using her own DNA is what created this Stussy right here and now. I bring this up because typically when you're talking about clones, and this is true in our world and also seems to be true in One Piece, when you clone somebody, you don't clone them as an adult. They have to start as a baby and they grow into an adult, right? That's how it works, right? So it wouldn't make any sense for this Stussy in Cipher Pool Zero to be in MADS like 30, 40 something years ago or whatever when it first was founded. Makes more sense for the original Miss Buckingham Stussy to be part of MADS, using her own DNA, her own lineage factor, creating a clone of herself, and that clone as kind of her pseudo-daughter, basically, clone of herself, also daughter, I guess, and then grows up to become this Stussy. Now, there's some also, you throw a few wrenches in this as well, because if she does have the ability of a vampire zone or even a succubus zone, they both have the ability to kind of absorb life essence from others. With vampires, it's through blood. With succubi, it's through, like, your soul or, like, your essence or whatever. You know, succubi are also mythological fantasy characters that have, like, a laundry list of things that they can do or can't do, depending on, you know, whichever author's writing that on at the time. So maybe she could use her ability. Maybe she's a lot older, but she can make herself look young because of the ability. I'm not really sure on that. Now, it was also stated in the box that she's the clone of Miss Buckingham Stussy of the Rocks Pirates, which implies that Miss Bucking, who is Weevil's mom, at least purportedly Weevil's mother, was also a member of the Rocks crew, which that was already established because Marco said as much. You know, Miss Bucking and Whitebeard were on a crew, you know, way back in the day, which was Rocks' crew. So she probably was a member of Mad's first. Wait, no. Timelines. Got to think of the timelines here, Matt. Okay. She was a member of Rox's crew first, probably, because Rox's crew ended 38 years ago at God Valley. Okay, then the crew disbanded, and so then she would have joined Mads. I think it makes more sense for Mads to, like, when we saw Vegapunk in his younger years, that was probably 30-something years ago. 30-something years ago. By the way, Caesar Clown's age has been changed. He used to be listed at age 40, which doesn't make any sense because in the backstory he would have been, like, 10, and he clearly wasn't. So Caesar's age has been changed now to be now, like, 55. So he's, like, the same age as Judge and Queen, and Vegapunk's, like, 65, and then, you know, Caesar's 55. Okay, so that makes more sense now. There had to be a little bit of a retcon there. Otherwise, this just doesn't make sense for Caesar to be there. So if Mads was formed 30 years ago, something like that, and then about 10 or so years in Mads, and then the government gets involved, Vegapunk joins the government, Mads splits up, and they all go their separate ways, that makes more sense. So Miss Bucking, who's really old, by the way, Miss Buckingham, who is Weevil's mom, she's 76. Okay, so she's, like, roughly around the same age as Whitebeard, okay, so she's pretty old. So, like, let's say 40 years ago, Miss Bucking would have been 36, and that's, like, and then even earlier than that, because Rox's crew was destroyed 38 years ago, but they were active over that, like, 40, 45 years ago, and then the crew disbands 38 years ago, God Valley, and then she joins Mads, and then she works together with Vegapunk and Caesar and Judge and Queen with the clone technology and everything, extracts her own DNA, creates a clone of herself, that clone grows up, is a succubus, has the ability to absorb life essence, so she stays perpetually young. There it is! There you go! There we go! Holy crap! And then it's also said in the other box, Mads' first successful clone, Unit 01, which kind of implies there's Unit 0203. Also, it says first successful clone. There might be some unsuccessful clones along the way. There might be a weird clone of, like, Judge or Queen out there somewhere that, you know, you ever see that episode of Venture Brothers with Dean's botched clone? Yeah, it might be something like that out there. But Stussy is the first successful clone. She was actually given a unit number, Unit 01. I wonder if she has, like, if she, like, puts her hair back or something, she has, like, a 1, like, stenciled on her neck or something, like she's a robot. Not really a robot, she's a clone. Also, here's the bigger question, and I'm actually going to leave this as a separate video because this is a whole new bag of hammers at this point. Why is Stussy doing... Why did she all of a sudden decide to just reveal herself as a succubi and vampire and bite Kaku's neck? Like, I understand he has a giant neck, and if she is a vampire, then I mean that kind of, like, you know. But why did she decide to do this now all of a sudden? Like, what's her game plan here? That's a discussion for another day, although I will bring up here that I see two main possibilities that I will explore later. The first possibility is that she's always worked for Vegapunk. She's always been loyal to Mads, okay? So rather, what if, like, she was working with Vegapunk from the very beginning because they literally gave her life, and so she's like, okay, I will go and be a double agent working for the underworld, but also be a triple agent working for the Cipher Pole, and now she's finally like, okay, now I'm fighting back, because... the Frontier Dome is active, and it was even stated, Lucci and Kaku and the Seraphim, they can't leave now. They're stuck. They're locked in. So what if Stussy is like, oh, this is the perfect opportunity for me to help out Vegapunk. I'm going to bite Lucci and Kaku, knock them out. Then the Vegapunks will come out, reclaim the Seraphim, and then my mission will be, you know, completed. You know, there it is. You know, Stussy is working for Vegapunk. Could just be that, and the Revolutionary Army by extension. The other thing is she could just be her own person. She could be like, I might be a clone of Miss Buckingham. I might have been created by Mads, but I'm my own person. I do what I want. So she could have her own agenda, like joining Cypherpol Zero, becoming the Pleasure District Queen or whatever, another reason why she's probably a succubus. All of that could just be her own goals and ambitions that she had. She left Mads. She's not working for anybody anymore. She's her own person. Could be that too. Anyway, I will explore that in another video. Thanks you guys for watching. And now we will end it out with some good old quail facts. Go ahead. All right, so on this riveting installment of Quail Facts, we're going to be talking about the California quail. The California quail is native to California, no surprise there, although there are a lot of them in New Zealand as well. Ironically enough, a lot of the pictures I found of the California quail were taken in New Zealand. You know, what can you say? Anyway, so the California quail is actually the state bird of California, because states have birds. Also, there's like state insects, state reptiles, state mammals, but state birds. The ruffed grouse is the Pennsylvania state bird, the ruffed grouse, in case you're curious. But we have this California quail, which represents California. You know, it's a very social bird. It tends to do things called dust baths, where it'll find like a very dry area where it'll like. And by the way, I mean it's rather adorable, right? It's a small little ball of a bird, and it'll just find a little spot on the ground, and it'll just kind of dig itself into the dirt, and then just flap around and get dust all over the place. But that's how it uses a dust bath. I'm not really sure the overall purpose of that, but it does it. They are capable of flight, but they do a thing called flushing, which is just basically, if you've ever seen like a bird get startled and then like fly away a little bit, like a chicken will like flap its wings and gain a little bit of air time, but just go back down. Although California quails, I think, are totally capable of flying 100%, unlike chickens. It's just that, it's just that they prefer to run away. So, you know, they'll usually just run away from you or flap their wings very briefly to get some airtime and just flush and just get away. But they choose to run. That's pretty much all the exciting things about California quails. Yeah, I'm thinking maybe like one or two more episodes of Quail Facts before we move on here. Birds are, I'm not saying all birds aren't that interesting, but, quails are, okay. Anyway, thanks for watching, everyone. Tekig, signing out.